So we have completed control structure. Then we have also done some, or we have done some operations on array as well as strings. So today we are going to talk about functions. So what is a function? So function can be considered as a mini program. Like you have your big program. Suppose or big problem. So you have your big problem. And you can segregate that big problem to some small chunk of problems. So small problem 1, SP2, SP3, SP4, SP5, and SP6. Suppose you have some big problem and you are trying to segregate those big problems into some small problems. So, in case of C programming, we actually call these small programs functions. So they works or their working is kind of similar to what a program does. So what a program does, so this basically does, so you have your program, you give some inputs to the program. Program actually processes. So it processes those inputs, and based on the processing, it produces some output. So this is what is happening inside a program. So a function is basically a small program. So this is your function. It also has some inputs. It produces some outputs in most of the cases. In some cases, actually prints those values. So it also does some processing here. So what is difference between a program and processing? The difference is how we actually provide the inputs. So that is not always different. So function has some specific criteria. Using those criteria, we actually provide some inputs to the function. Whereas programs generally take inputs from the user. So let's start with a function. So first of all, function declaration. Or rather, let's find out what are the different parts of function. So number one, you have function declaration. Number two, you have function definition. Number three, you have function calling. So function declaration, function definition, and function calling. So these three are the components of any function. So whenever you are trying to write your own function, so you have to use these two components. So this is for writing a function. And this function call is used to use the written function. So this is used to use the written function. So we use function call to actually use the user-defined functions. Whereas we have those function prototype and function declaration, sorry, function definition and function declaration that is used to write a function. So function declaration is also known as function prototype. So let's find out how we can actually write the function declaration and in which situations we require a function. And what are the scopes of a function? So, syntax of function or you know what is syntax? Syntax is basically the grammar that is used for programming languages. So, syntax for writing a function so function declaration. Or we call it prototype or sometimes call it header. Okay, so syntax of function declaration or prototypes if real type return type followed by a function name. So each function has a unique name. So this name has to be an identifier. So we have learned what are the properties of identifier is in the first review session, I guess. So from that you can remember what is identifier. So function is identifier or function name is identifier, and all functions will have this opening first bracket and closing first bracket. So it indicates the set of arguments. So here you provide arguments. So this is the basic syntax of any function prototype, So this is the basic syntax of any function prototype. So now this argument can be of or can be written in two ways. So one could be like data type, one where one comma data type, two where two, and so on. So you can have as many arguments as you want. So each of them is called argument. So var1 or data type is actually the argument, and data type 2 var2 is the argument 2. Or you can have a data type n var n. So you can have any number of arguments here in this particular fashion, or you can actually just write the data type. Data type, comma data type, comma data type. So suppose data type again. So 1, 2. So you can have any number of data types in this matter. This is how a function header looks. Now, what are the purposes it serves or a function header serves? So first purpose of function header is to define the characteristics or the basic characteristics of the function and what we can actually assume from this function prototype. So first of all, the function name should be a meaningful function name. That means it should define or it should specify what kind of operation is going to happen. So this is not mandatory, but this is convention. Convention means you can say it is a rule, not like it is mandatory or something. It is just a rule that follows or that followed by any programmer. So function name should specify the content or what are the context of that particular function is. Like if you are trying to write a function to find out whether a number is a prime number or not, so function names could be like this: prime, check prime, prime number, is prime. So I will prefer from this all these four names, I will prefer is prime as one of the best function name for a particular function that can find out whether a particular function or whether a particular number is prime number or not. So you can have something like this. But if you write a program or a function that is used to check whether a number is prime number or not, and you are writing the function name as odd even, so that is so syntactically that is correct. But if you think as a programmer, that particular name is not suitable at that particular context. So function name should specify what is the context or what are the reason of that particular function. Argument specifies what will be the input to that particular function. So what are the different type of data that you are going to give to this particular function. So data type, this specifies that what kind of data you are going to give to that particular function. And return type specifies what kind of data you are expecting from your function. And if you are not expecting any return value from your function, then this data type should be void. So this is a new data type that you have not learned in primitive data type. So any primitive data type can be a return type. Type of data type, primitive or derived or user defined, except functions, can be the return type of any function.
and you have a new written type called void, so that you have already learned in case of a main function, right? So you can either have a main function void main, or you can have int main. So that is actually writing the return type of that main, or specifying what will be the return type from the main. So void means that particular function is not going to return anything. So you can understand from this, from the function declaration only, all this information can be monitored or can be understood by that particular header. So where we are going to use this particular header, or why, when we are going to specify that particular header. So this particular header must be declared before you are going to call that particular function. So before the calling statement, you can have anywhere in your program that particular function declaration. Okay, now suppose you want to use, or you want to call a particular function inside the main function. So suppose you want a particular function to be called here. So what you have to do, you have to either declare that particular function here, or you have to declare the particular function outside the main. Now it depends, or the scope of that particular function depends on where you have declared. If you have declared in the global section, that means outside of any function, so that particular function is accessible to all the other functions or other blocks in your program. But if you have specified that particular function inside the main, so that particular function is only accessible to the main. So the same kind of visibility and scope that you have seen in case of variables is shown here by the functions as well. So in certain situation, function declaration or function prototype writing is not required. What is that situation? So the situation is, if you are going to use, or if you are going to write the definition of the function along with the function declaration at that particular time, you don't actually require the function declaration. So function declaration, what it does, it actually specifies, or it actually the instructions that you are giving to that particular function to how to do that particular operation. Suppose so let's take an example of function declaration first. So example of function declaration, suppose. Say you have int add int int, or alternatively you can write it like this: int add int a comma int b with a semicolon. So this is an example of function declaration. So what we can understand from this particular function, though both of them are same, one with the variables, another one without any variables. So in this particular example we have used the variable, and in this particular example we have not used a variable, and both of them means the same to the compiler. So what we can actually assume, or what we can get from this function function declaration, that is, this particular function is used to add two integer numbers and produce an integer result. So this is what we can actually conclude from this particular function declaration. So what is a function definition? Function definition means writing the steps to perform the desired operation. So writing the steps to perform the desired operation. So that is actually what we do using programs. Like using programs, we instruct computers, or instructs our machines to do certain operations, and we actually write down what are the steps to do that particular operation. So similarly, here also we have to mention that particular thing or particular operations. So here is a special command that is used to return some value, and that special command is known as return. So if you want to return some value from your function, or if you want to abruptly return from your program, you can use this return command. So we are going to use or we are going to check what are the working of this return command later. So this is the special command that you can actually use to return some value from your function or abruptly terminate that particular function. So let's find out how we can actually write the function definition. So let's see what is the syntax of function definition. The syntax is simple, just follow the syntax of function declaration. So it will be return type, function name, followed by, this time you have to specify the data type along with the argument. So you have to use this particular version of the function declaration. So data type var1, comma data type var2, and so on, and we don't place a semicolon here, and this is our body. Body means where we put some of the operations or the steps that are required to follow to perform that particular task. So for example, if you want to write the definition of this particular function what we are going to do, we are going to write int add int a comma int b, no semicolon. So then what we are trying to do, we are trying to add a and b and return that particular value to through this particular function. So what we have to do, you have to use another variable, say int c. C is equal to a plus b, and now we have to use this special command return to return some value. So return c. So that is our addition. So we are returning that particular value using this return keyword to the calling function. So how we can call it, we are going to learn that next. So this is how you can actually return some value from your function to the calling function. Calling function means the function that has called or that has asked for that particular operation. Now, yeah, so I put the semicolon. So the difference between the function definition and function declaration is this function definition or function prototype can have there is no need to mention the variables in function declaration. You can mention it, that is fine. It ends with a semicolon, whereas function definition doesn't end with a semicolon. It is followed, the header, function header is followed by the opening curly braces and end curly braces. And in between that, we write the body of the function or the statements that actually the function is going to perform. So this is how you can actually write a function that can return some value. So this particular function can also be alternatively written like this: int add int a comma int b, return a plus b. So this is another way how you can minimize the number of steps in your function. So you don't need this particular variable c, you can just directly return the addition of these two numbers. So this is how you can actually upgrade your functions to minimize the number of codes. So this is again function. Now there are some situations where you actually don't require this function declaration. So what is the situation and where we can actually use the function definition? So suppose you have your main. So in every program you have main function, and you want to call this particular function here. So add Suppose you are calling this particular function. How? We are going to check it later. So suppose you want to call or you want to use this particular function inside the main. So what you can write? You can actually write the function prototype here and function definition here. Or you can write the function definition here. So either you can write the function definition at the end or at the beginning of this particular function. It depends on the programmer. Now, what is the advantage of function definition? That if you are using or if you are writing the function definition at the beginning of using or at first, so before the use of your function or before the call of your first call of your function, if you are trying to write the function definition, then there is no need to specify the function prototype. So you don't need to specify the function prototype. You are defining your function before you are going to use it. But if you are writing the function definition at the end or after you have used that particular function, then you must declare or you must write the prototype. Mind the difference. If you are writing the function definition before you are using that particular function, there is no need to define the prototype. But if you are writing the function definition after you have used your function, then you must specify the function prototype at the beginning, so that compiler can understand that this particular function belongs to this particular prototype and this particular prototype is being defined later on in the program. To create the link, you must at least specify the function name along with its arguments or type of arguments, so that compiler can understand. Why? Because all C program is actually being compiled from top to bottom. So that's why if you are defining or if you don't write the function prototype, the program will not understand what this particular statement is specified when it reaches to this particular location. That's why either you have to specify the prototype of the program, or you can actually shift the function definition part completely here without any function prototype. So there are two scenarios. One, you are defining your function without function prototype before you are using that particular function. Another situation is you are defining the function prototype and defining, you are declaring the function prototype and defining the function after using that particular function. So you can use one of these scenarios depending on your choice. We actually prefer this kind of scenarios because writing the function definition beforehand is actually gives us the flexibility of not writing the function prototype, that is an extra statement. So we try to reduce the number of lines that you have to write. And now how we can actually use the function. So that is called function calling. It is simple. So there are two ways to use function call. There is not two ways. There is only one way. So use the function name along with arguments. So this particular argument, this type of arguments are known as formal argument. Formal arguments means they are the placeholder, they are not the actual arguments. And this time in function calling, you have to specify the actual arguments. So they are called actual arguments. So what you are required? You are required to use the function name along with the argument. You don't have to specify the return type or anything. Now there is a catch. If some function returns some value, you must use that value. So if some function is returning some value, you must capture that value. Capture that value in the sense either using lvalue equal to function. Or you can simply use it like printf, some format specifier, suppose d function name, or using any other function. You must use that particular value that is returned from your function. So you must remember that if some function is returning some value, you must use that particular value. And if it is not returning anything, then that is fine. So now, how actually you can use this particular function? So we have written the definition of this particular function or this one. So how can you use this particular function? So suppose inside main, we have this main. We have int a is equal to 5, int b is equal to 6, suppose, and we want c is equal to at a comma So these are the actual arguments. Okay, these are the actual arguments. And now you are printing that result. So printf percent d plus percent d equal to percent d a comma b comma c return 0. So this is our main function where we have used the function call. So this is our function call where we have used this particular function. So either you can use lvalue to actually capture that particular value, or you can actually use them. So instead of c, you can actually write add a comma b. So that is also fine, and that will also reduce the number of statements. So this is how you can call a particular function. Now there are two different ways to call a particular function. One is called call by value, another one is called call by reference. So I am coming to this particular point. So let me so to represent or to specify call by reference, we have to learn a new concept called pointers. That is our next topic. So what is call by value? Call by value means the changes made to formal parameter is not reflected in actual parameter. I'm going to show the example. And number two, reverse. Reverse of this. What does it mean? The changes made to the formal parameter is or not reverse basically. It is the negative of this. Negative of this. That means the changes made to the formal parameter is going to reflect in the actual parameter. So my next example is actually showing how this is happening. So call by value means the parameters that the actual parameters are being called by their value. Whereas in case of reference, they are the actually they are passed by their references, or sometimes this is called call by pointer. Okay. So for my next example is going to show you what is the difference or what is actually call by value is. So suppose we want a particular function. So call by value versus call by reference.
swap using call by value.
So what do we want? We want to swap two numbers. Swap two numbers means, suppose you have a is equal to 10 and b is equal to 20. You want a is equal to 20 and b is equal to 10. So that is what we mean by swap. Okay, so a is equal to 10, b is equal to 20, and a will become 20 and b will become 10. Now for this particular purpose, we want to write a particular function. So the function will look like this. So we are not writing the header, we are directly going to define it. So remember one thing. So function declaration is declaring that particular function. That means what that particular function is going to do, just an assumption. Function declaration or function definition is the actual actual option to actually write the content of that particular function. So whenever we are writing a particular function by our own, that means we are actually defining, or we are actually writing the body of that particular function, and that is why they are called user defined function. So whenever it doesn't depend on the function declaration, it doesn't depend on the function calling, the user defined function is depend on the function definition. That means who is writing the definition, whether it is written by the compiler or inside the compiler, or the user or the programmer is writing the own definition of that particular function. Depending on that, we decide on whether that function is a predefined function. Predefined function means the functions that are available in different header files of C library, like the functions that we have used in our previous lecture or previous review session, where we had functions like strlen, or strcat, strcopy, strcompare. So those functions are those functions are predefined function, whereas the function that we have just written, like this one, int add int a comma int b, is a user defined function. Okay, now from that perspective, can anyone tell me what is a main function? The main function is whether it is user defined or it is predefined function. Yeah, so main, the definition of the declaration of main is inside the compiler or inside the library of the C. Declaration or the prototype of that main is already declared. Why or when it is being called, that is also declared. That means the call of main is also mentioned in the library. But what main does, for every program we write our own content, or we write our own main function. That means we write the definition of the main. So main is considered to be a user defined function, not a predefined function. Okay, so that's a good answer, that main is a user defined function. So where I was, so we are about to write a function that is going to alter the values between themselves. Okay, so what we can write, so we actually don't need any return type, because we don't want any value, we want to just swap their values. So the return type will be void. Okay, so for naming, we use the name suppose swap, and we have variable a and variable p. And one more interesting thing, that so you have learned this actual argument or actual parameter and the formal parameter. So interestingly, we have the same name, int a int b here, and as well as in the calling we have a and b. So that doesn't necessarily be the same. That means formal parameter and actual parameter can be of different name. That means the variable names can be different. That doesn't matter in case of function definition or function calling. Okay, so the names of those variables can be different. So we are using, for this particular example, we are going to use different name so that I can explain what is happening here. So void swap int a int b. Now what is the way of swapping? So there are two ways, one using temporary variable, another one using without using temporary variable. So we are just simply using a temporary variable. So int t, t is equal to a is equal to b, and b is equal to t. So this actually swaps the formal parameter. So a and b, the value of a and b are swapped, correct or not? If you follow this instruction set, the value of a and b are being swapped, right or not? Yes, so this value is being swapped. Now what we can do inside the main, so suppose we have a main function. So forget about return type and header and all this. So we have int x is equal to suppose 10 and int y is equal to suppose 20. So what we are expecting from this particular function call, that the value of x will become 20 and the value of y will become 10. So what we are going to do, we are first of all, we are going to print the values. So printf %d, %d, x, y. We are going to print again, so printf %d, %d, this time x, y again, assuming that if we call swap, so it doesn't return anything, so we can just simply call it like this, x, y. So what we are expecting, what will be the, what is our expected output from this particular program? So this is our expected output. And our, suppose you have a slash in here, actual output. So what we are expecting here, we are expecting 10, 20, and in the next line 20, 10. But what we are actually going to get, 10, 20 and 10, 20. How? I am going to explain now. So this particular example shows that this particular function follows the call by value principle. What is call by value principle? So when you are actually giving the actual parameters to your functions, what is happening? Something like this kind of statement is happening. So this x value is being copied to a and y value is being copied to b. What is happening? In the memory you have x and y. So you have x and y. And inside x you have 10, inside y you have 20. Okay, so now when this particular function call is happening, what is happening here? So this statements become int a is equal to x and int b is equal to y. What does that mean? A and b are created. So a and b are created and a becomes 10 and y becomes 20. So when you swap them, what is happening after some time, so A become 20 and B become 10. But it doesn't mean that we have changed the value of X and Y. That means these values have been copied to A and B. The value of A and B are then swapped with each other. And this doesn't reflect it on the actual parameter, because there is no link between the actual parameter and this past parameter, because they are passed by the value. That means what we have expected from this swap function could not do the intended job. So this particular scenario is called pass by value, and in most of the scenarios or most of the cases we write functions that uses pass by value, until and unless we require something or some situation where we need to use this particular property or the negative of this particular property, like the changes that we are going to make to the formal parameter is going to reflect on the actual parameter. The same situation is actually required for this particular function. For this swap function, we actually require something in such a way that A is remain connected with X and B remains connected with Y in throughout this particular session or throughout this particular program or particular function, so that whatever changes we are going to make inside A and B is going to reflect on X and Y. So how we can actually do that? For that, we have to learn a specific type of variable called pointer variable. So we are going to discuss pointers first, then we are again going to move into this particular topic, that means pass by value or call by value or call by referent. So what is a pointer? So from this particular section you have some quiz problems, at least two or three problems are from this particular section, pointer section. So be careful on this particular topic. So what is a pointer? It is a special variable used to store the address of other variables. So pointer type of variables are a special variable that is used to store address of other variables. And what is the difference between variable and a pointer? Variable can store any type of variable, whereas pointer actually stores the address of any type of variable. Now, when we specify the address of any type of variable, so as you know that address are numbered inside the memory, we have learned this in previous class that address are numbered inside the memory, and addresses cannot be negative. That means we don't need to specify, or we don't need to have that signed option. That means we don't need the negative part. That means a pointer variable is always unsigned. Okay, so a pointer variable is always unsigned. Now, I don't know if you guys ever wondered what is by what you understand by this 32-bit machine, 64-bit machine, so I don't know if you have wondered by hearing 32-bit machine or 62-bit machine, or 32-bit Android, 64-bit Android, 32-bit processor, 62-bit processor. I don't know if you have wondered or not, but they are very interesting and they have some deep meaning. So 32-bit machine means it can use 32-bit, it can handle 32 bits for a certain situation or for a particular moment of time. And similarly, 64-bit means it can handle 64 bits at a particular time. Now generally you can use 32 bits. So for 32-bit machine we use 32 bits for memory representation. Memory representation, that means you can actually specify 2 to the power 32 locations. So if you can roughly use that, it will be 4 GB. That means a 32-bit machine cannot allocate more than 4 GB space. It is not possible physically. Okay, so there are different ways to allocate that. In a 32-bit machine can also have 6 GB or 8 GB RAM, but those things are extensible. That means there are different ways to that, but physically it is not possible for a 32-bit machine to have more than more space than 4 GB. Similarly, if your machine is a 64-bit machine, you can have 2 to the power 64 locations. So it will be roughly 32 GB or more, not 32 GB, it will be more than that. Okay, so that means if you have a 64-bit machine, you can have a larger memory. So generally, if you have a 8 GB machine, the higher chances is that your machine is a 64-bit machine. So we need to actually specify, or we need to have this much location. That means your locations, or your you need 32 or 64 bits to represent this location. Okay, So what will happen? You have, first of all, you have this unsigned options. That means you don't need the negative part. Now, how many bits are required? We actually need 64 bits. So how many bytes are required for this particular representation? That means for specifying or to storing each of these addresses, we need actually 64 bit space at least. So 64 bit means, so if you one byte is equal to 8 bits. So how many bytes of 64 bits? So 64 bit means how many bytes? Just 64 divided by 8. 64 bits means 8 bytes, right? So 64 bit means 8 bytes. So that means you need 8 bytes to represent a pointer. So the size of the pointer is, or the data type that actually pointer follows, is unsigned long integer. So unsigned long integer is the type of pointer. And what is the size? It is 8 byte. So if you have a pointer variable, suppose x is a pointer variable, and if you use size of x, the value that you are going to get is 8. So this is what you will get if you are trying to print the size of any pointer. Any pointer variable will have this particular size, 8 byte, depending on if it is a 64 bit machine. If it is a 32 bit machine, it will be 4 byte, but the type is same, unsigned long integer. So that is the data type of pointer variable. And what is the size? It is 8 byte. So if you define a pointer variable, the size of that pointer variable is 8 byte. It doesn't depend on what type of pointer it is. So we just in the next slide, we are going to learn how you can create pointers. But remember that whenever you define a pointer of some different type, that doesn't mean the pointer belongs to that particular type and size of the pointer belongs to that particular type. Pointer is always used to store a particular address, and addresses are represented using 16-bit number or 16 bits. To represent those 16 bits, you actually need 8 bytes of space. So that is fixed. So how we can actually define a pointer? To define pointer, we have to specify the data type followed by a star, then pointer variable name. So this is how you can define a pointer. So for example, we can have a pointer like int pointer p. So we have this particular pointer. Now what this pointer means? So by simply having a look and having the concept of variable, you can actually say that this is an integer pointer, or this particular pointer is of type integer, but that is not the case. This is an integer pointer, but the type of this pointer is not integer. The type of this pointer is always unsigned long integer. Okay, so what is this particular integer star p or char star cp? So cp is the name, you can have any name. So this is a pointer, character pointer, this is an integer pointer. What this particular thing specifies? So this particular pointer specifies p is a pointer that points, or rather that can point to a location where a integer can be stored. And CP is a pointer that can point to a location where a character or char can be stored. Okay, so this is what we meant when we are trying to declare a pointer. That means if you write integer pointer, that means a pointer that can point or that can point to a location, that means that can store a particular location data where an integer can be stored. Whereas a character pointer or CP in this particular example is a pointer that can point to a location where a character can be stored. That means a char type of data can be stored. So what is happening here? So if you write this particular statement int star p, what will happen in the memory? A location will be created. The name of this location is p and the size of this particular location is 8 byte, and in this particular location you can store a particular value. That value can store, so suppose integer, if integer takes 4 byte, so suppose this is 4 byte, so you have 4 bytes, it can be used to store integer, and it has some ADDR. So ADDR, suppose address, this address will be stored here. Now this particular pointer is not pointing to anything, so this is called dangling pointer. A pointer variable that is not pointing to anything is called either a dangling pointer or null pointer. You can say it a null pointer. That means a pointer that is not pointing to anything. So that means at present moment, this pointer is, a pointer doesn't hold anything. That means this pointer doesn't have anything. It is a just null pointer. You have declared a pointer, that means you have declared a particular variable that can store a particular location or particular location data that can have an integer value. Now, how we can actually assign some values to our pointers? For that, you need int a is equal to 5. So suppose this is a variable where you have stored 5. So this is a location where you have stored 5. And the address of this location is suppose ADDR. Now you have to write p is equal to ampersand of a. That means you are assigning or you are writing p is equal to ampersand of a. That means you know that ampersand operator returns the address of a particular variable. So this is returning the address. So you are assigning that particular address to this pointer variable. You cannot have a variable, normal variable p is equal to 5. And if you write p is equal to ampersand of a, so that is different thing. And this time this is different thing. So this is how you can actually assign or initialize your pointer variables. So if you write p is equal to ampersand of a, what will happen? ADDR will come here. That means inside the pointer variable location, the address of that particular variable is being assigned. Now you can actually use this particular pointer, we actually change the value of this 5. So in the next slide, we are going to do that, how we can actually do or how we can actually access this particular value using this pointer. So this pointer variable can actually access this particular 5. That means at this present scenario or at this present situation, this storage area have two accesses. One, you can use A to change the value in this particular location. Also, you can actually use P or this particular pointer to actually change this location. Now this particular statement, that means statement 1, and this particular statement, this is statement 2, can be merged together to form a statement like int star p is equal to ampersand of a, if you have already defined int a is equal to 5. So then this particular statement is used to declare, that means define and initialize a pointer variable with a single statement, whereas this is initialization and this is declaration statement of a pointer variable. So have you got the idea? That means this time in this particular situation, we have one location that is accessed by two different variables, one using a pointer variable, another using a variable of integer or integer type of variable, that is A. So A can access that particular location and P can also access that particular location. And this particular logic is going to serve as the basis of pass by reference. That means what we want, so if you go to this particular example, what we want, we don't want a copy of x and y into A and B. What we want to actually access this particular location, so that whatever changes we make in A can be reflected here and whatever changes we made to B can be reflected here. So this is what we wanted and this is what we are actually getting using a pointer variable. Now let us discuss how this pointer variable can be used to actually change some values here or get the values from this particular location. So I will write some print statement. So use of pointers. Konta bolo? Yeah, 32 bit hole 2 byte hobe jodi 64 bit hoy tale 4 byte hobe integer er khetre int a jodi tumi bolo then it defines a 4 byte of area, right? But what about the address? এই 4 বাইট যে লোকেশন আছে তার অ্যাড্রেসটা কত বাইটের? 4 বাইটের এরিয়া মিন্স কি চারটে 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 বিট, চারটে বাইট পর পর পর, ঠিক আছে? আমি স্টার্টিং অ্যাড্রেসটা যদি ধরি তাহলে প্রত্যেকটা অ্যাড্রেস মানে প্রত্যেকটা লোকেশন কত বিট করে জায়গা নিচ্ছে স্টোর হওয়ার জন্য, মানে ডিনোট করার জন্য? 8 বাইট করে, মানে 64 বিট করে আমার প্রত্যেকটা লোকেশন, তাই তো? তো প্রত্যেকটা লোকেশন যদি 64 বিট করে হয় তাহলে আমাকে পি এর মধ্যে কতগুলো বিট স্টোর করতে হবে, মানে পয়েন্টারের মধ্যে কতগুলো বিট স্টোর করতে হবে? পুরো অ্যাড্রেসটাই তো আমাকে স্টোর করতে হবে। মানে তোমার বাড়ির সাপোজ পিনকোড হচ্ছে 6টা ডিজিটের, ঠিক আছে, আর তুমি একটা পয়েন্টার ভেরিয়েবল ধরছো বা তুমি একটা ভেরিয়েবল ধরছো যার মধ্যে তোমাকে তোমার পিনকোডটা রাখতে বলেছে, তাহলে তুমি কি 6টা ডিজিটের জায়গায় 4টে ডিজিটে তোমার পিনকোড রাখবে না 6টা ডিজিটই রাখবে? তো 6টা রাখার জন্য তোমাকে কতগুলো জায়গা লাগবে? 6টা বিটেরই জায়গা লাগবে, তাহলে 64টা বিটের যেহেতু অ্যাড্রেস আছে তাহলে তোমার কতগুলো জায়গা লাগবে? চৌষট্টিটা বিট লাগছে একটা অ্যাড্রেস রিপ্রেজেন্ট করতে, তোমাকে একটা অ্যাড্রেস রাখার জন্য কতগুলো তাহলে বিট লাগছে? 64 খানাই তো বিট লাগবে। বোঝা গেল না? পিনকোড আমার 6টা ডিজিট আছে পিনকোডে, তো তো পিনকোড তোমাকে স্টোর করতে গেলে কতগুলো ঘর লাগবে? তো 64 খানা যদি ঘর থাকে তোমার পিনকোডে তাহলে কতগুলো ঘর লাগবে তোমার? তো অ্যাড্রেসে যখন 64 খানা ঘর আছে তাহলে আমার পয়েন্টার ভেরিয়েবলটা তো অ্যাড্রেস স্টোর করবে, তাহলে পয়েন্টার ভেরিয়েবলে কতগুলো ঘর লাগবে? বোঝা গেছে? সো বিকজ অ্যাড্রেস ইজ অলওয়েজ 64 বিট, দ্যাট মিনস 8 বাইট, দ্যাটস ওয়াই দ্য সাইজ অফ দ্য পয়েন্টার ইজ অলসো 8 বাইট অলওয়েজ, দ্যাট ইজ আনসাইন্ড ইন্টিজার, আনসাইন্ড লং ইন্টিজার।
ইফ
Yes, pointer, the type of pointer doesn't specify what kind of pointer it is. The type of pointer, what it specifies that which kind of variable or which kind of data it can point to. That means কোন টাইপের ভেরিয়েবল তার অ্যাড্রেসটাকে পয়েন্টারটাই স্টোর করবে। দ্যাট মিনস ইন্ট স্টার পি ডাজন স্পেসিফাই দ্যাট দিস পার্টিকুলার পয়েন্টার ইজ অফ টাইপ ইন্টিজার। ইট স্পেসিফাইজ দ্যাট দিস পার্টিকুলার পয়েন্টার ক্যান পয়েন্ট টু এ লোকেশন। দ্যাট মিনস ইট ক্যান স্টোর আ পার্টিকুলার লোকেশন হোয়ার এ ইন্টিজার ক্যান বি প্লেসড। বুঝা গেছে? দ্যাট মিনস 4 বাইট জায়গা একসাথে নিয়ে ও ডিনোট করছে যে দিস পার্টিকুলার পয়েন্টার ইজ স্টোরিং দিস পার্টিকুলার অ্যাড্রেস। বুঝে গেছে? সিমিলারলি ক্যারেক্টার সিপি ডাজন্ট স্পেসিফাই দ্যাট দিস পার্টিকুলার পয়েন্টার বিলংস টু এ ক্যারেক্টার। ইট স্পেসিফাইজ দ্যাট ইট ক্যান পয়েন্ট টু এ লোকেশন ওয়্যার ইউ ক্যান কিপ আ ক্যারেক্টার টাইপ অফ ডেটা। ক্লিয়ার হয়েছে ব্যাপারটা? ওকে, সো লেটস মুভ ইন টু দ্য ইউজেস অফ পয়েন্টার। সো হোয়াট উই ক্যান রাইট, সো সাপোজ উই হ্যাভ ইন্ট a is equal to 5 and we have an integer pointer ampersand of a. So what we have done inside the memory, so suppose this is a, we have 5 here, and this is p, so suppose this is addr, so we have addr here. Okay, so now I am writing some codes, printing codes. So printf, percent d a, printf percent d ampersand of a, printf percent d ampersand, sorry, p, printf percent d ampersand of p. And you are going to introduce with a new operator, pointer operator, pointer p. So we have 5 different operations. Now first 2 operations are known to you, right? So suppose addr is an integer value, suppose this addr is a unsigned long integer value that is representing the address of this particular location. So what will be the output from this printf percent da? Anyone? What will be the address? So it will be 5. What will be the output from here? Printf percent d ampersand of a. As you know, the address of this particular variable addr. That means a, the address of a is addr. So what will be the output from here? Yeah, addr. Considering that addr is unsigned integer of 8 bit. Now what will be the value of this this particular expression, printf percent dp? So generally what we are going to print or what we are going to access using this particular variable, the content of that variable, right? Like when we have written printf percent da, we have accessed the content of a, so that is 5. So what is the content of p? So this particular statement is actually going to write addr. Suppose this particular p is stored in a location addr1. Suppose this particular pointer p is stored in a location called addr. So from your logic, from this second statement, printf percent d ampersand of a, that produces the result addr, what will be the output here? Printf percent d ampersand of p, what will be the output? Yes, so it will be addr1. That means the address of the variable p, that means where this particular variable p is being located. Now this is new to you, so this particular operation is called pointer access operator or indirect access operator. So this gives us to the access to the location where this particular P is pointing. So P is pointing to a location. So when you put the value or the address of A to P, a pointer is created. That means this particular P is now pointing to A. Now this particular star operator, or you can say pointer operator, or the value access operator, whatever you can say this particular operation, is used to access the value that is pointed by this location P or pointer P. So this particular operation will result in 5. So what we actually require this 2 and this 1. We generally don't require this. We generally don't, not that useful. So we actually require this 3 statement. What? First of all, we can actually access the value of A using that particular variable. Second of all, we can get the address of this particular variable using the address operator with the variable name. And thirdly, we can actually get the value of variable A using a pointer, using pointer operation. So star P will return the particular value. So if you write something like this, star P is equal to star P plus 1, what will happen? Anyone? Yes, so this particular value will become 6. And now if you print, after this operation, if you print the value of A, so %D, A, it will have 6 as a result. That means whatever you have changed using the pointer is going to reflect it on A as well, because A and P are connected. Clear? If you have any questions, you can ask. Is it clear how pointer actually works? So people actually think, so in my field, that means you are not from programming background, but people actually think this concept of pointer is very tough. So is it tough? বাকি গুলো থেকে দা বাট ইজ ইট দ্যাট টাফ মানে 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 বোঝাই যাবে না এমন কোন ব্যাপার মানে এটা কি আকাশ থেকে পড়েছে এমন মানে বাকি সি এর কনসেপ্ট যেগুলো আছে তার থেকে কি এটা এমন কিছু যে মানে বোঝাই যাচ্ছে না আকাশ থেকে পড়েছে এমন কোন ব্যাপার আছে না মোটামুটি বোঝা যাবে এটা আমি জাস্ট জিজ্ঞেস করছি দুটো কারণে এক হচ্ছে এটাকে সবাই খুব টাফ টপিক মনে করে মানে পয়েন্টারটাকে অ্যান্ড সেকেন্ডলি আমি আদৌ অ্যাকচুয়ালি বোঝাতে পারলাম কি না সেটা আমি জাস্ট বুঝতে চাইছি যে ইজ ইট দ্যাট টাফ মানে তোমরা কি ঠিকঠাক বুঝতে পেরেছো না পারোনি আমি জাস্ট সেটা জানতে চাই কারণ আমার মনে হয় না যে এটা খুব একটা টাফ জিনিস জাস্ট একটু কনসেপ্টটা ভিজুয়ালাইজ করতে পারলে মানে এরকম ছবি একটা ভেবে মাথায় ভেবে যদি আমি ভিজুয়ালাইজ করতে পারি যে ব্যাপারটা কি হচ্ছে অ্যান্ড হাউ দিস টু ভেরিয়েবলস আর কানেক্টেড উইথ ইচ আদার দেন আই ডোন্ট থিঙ্ক দিস ইজ আ ভেরি মাচ টাফ সাবজেক্ট অর ভেরি মাচ টাফ টপিক ইট ক্যান বি কনসিডার অ্যাজ নর্মাল দ্য সিম্পল ফর্মুলা ইজ দ্যাট আ ভেরিয়েবল অ্যান্ড অ্যানাদার ভেরিয়েবল দে আর লিঙ্কড উইথ ইচ আদার অ্যান্ড দ্যাট লিঙ্ক ইজ ডান বাই আ পয়েন্টার And you can directly access the same variable once using the pointer variable with a pointer or pointer operation with a pointer and another one. You just can simply use that particular variable. So now there are different other tough concepts on pointer or based on pointer. We may not touch those tough concepts, but I will explain some concepts today. So we are not going to deep details into pointers, but we are going to discuss some of these concepts. Okay. So using this particular concept and remember this particular declaration. it is going to used in pass by value. So after learning this much concept, we can actually move towards our call by reference or call by pointer section. So let's revisit call by reference. So now we have another mechanism where we can actually access same variable. We can access same variable or we can access same location using two different variables. One, if we have a pointer variable, and another one is a normal variable. So let's discuss how we can actually. Okay, wait a minute. Okay, so let's discuss the call by reference. So we are going to use the same problem. That is that we have used in case of here. That means we want to have something like this, that two variables are going to be swapped with each other, or two values are going to be swapped with each other. So this time we are going to write the main function first, and also we are going to start with the same version. So we had void swap int a comma int b, we had int t, t is equal to a, a is equal to b, and b is equal to a. So this is same as our previous example, and here we had our main function. So inside the main we had int x is equal to 10, y is equal to 20. Okay, and then we have print statement. So printf %d comma %d slash n x comma y. Here we have called swap method using x comma y. Printf %d %d comma x comma y. Okay, so this was our pass by reference. And what is happening in case of pass by reference? Int a is equal to x, int y is equal to int a is equal to x, and int is equal to y. So this is what happening when this function call is going on. Am I right? Am I right? From pass by value, we have seen that this kind of statement is going to happen whenever we call this swap function. Am I right? Okay. So what? Yes. কিছু বলছো? Okay. So what we can actually do, or how we can actually convert it to something else, like we have x and y here, and we have a and b here, a and b here. So what we actually want, we want a to point here and b to point here. So for that, what kind of statement we have to write? We have to write int star a is equal to ampersand of x and int star b is equal to ampersand of y, right? This is what we have learned here. Sorry. This is what we have learned. This is what we have learned here, right? This is the statement that actually gives us the flexibility to use the same location using two different variables, one using a pointer variable, another one is a normal variable. So this was the statement, int star p is equal to ampersand of a, where a is having some value. So the similar thing that needs to be done here, that is int pointer a is equal to ampersand of x in pointer b is equal to ampersand of y, right or wrong? Am I right, or the question should be, are you getting my point, that this is what we actually require? Nobody has got my point. So from pass by value and calling this particular function swap xy, what is happening internally, that this particular statement is executing. That means int a is equal to x, int b is equal to y. So this x value is copied to a and this y values is copied to b. So this kind of statement is being executed. But what we want that we can actually have a link like this. So we don't want a copy. So here it has 10, here it has 20. We don't want a copy. We don't want to copy the value of x to a. We don't want to copy the value of x to or y to b. What we want to somehow point a to x and point b to y, so that whenever we change something using the pointer of a and pointer of b, we can actually change x and y, that we have seen in this particular example. So we need this point. For that, what kind of statement we actually require? We don't require this kind of statement. We require this statement, int pointer a is equal to ampersand of x, int pointer b is equal to ampersand of y. These two statements will actually create an architecture like this. Yes. Have you guys able to get that? That we require this kind of statement. So first of all, this particular statement to point a to the address of x, and this particular statement in pointer b to point b to the address of y. So clear? So now what you have to do, you just have to segregate them. You have to segregate them. It becomes your actual parameter. And this becomes your formal parameter. That means you have to put a star here. So int star, and you have to return the address here. As simple as you can see. So this is your call by reference. So to use call by reference, you have to remember this particular statement. So whenever you are trying to use call by reference, you just have to use a pointer in actual formal parameter, and you have to pass the address of your actual parameter, not that value. So we are not passing the value, we are passing the address. So this is how this is happening. So if this particular statement can be interpreted, so it will be interpreted as int star a is equal to ampersand of a, that is equal to this. That means a link from a to x is created, and int star b ampersand of y, that means this particular link. So the link from b to y is created. So this is called pass by reference. That means whatever changes we are making in this particular section will be reflected here. But our job is not done yet. Why our job is not done yet? Because what will happen if you try to access the pointer directly? The address will be returned. How can we actually access the value using the pointer variable with the pointer operation with the pointer variable? So we have to change the code as well. That means t is equal to pointer a is equal to b, and pointer b is equal to t. So this is how your program should look like. So the function will be converted into this pointer function. That means the arguments become a pointer variables, and the values that you are going to use will also be accessed through the pointer operation with the variable on the pointer variable, and you will pass the value as their addresses. That means you are trying to pass the address of x and address of y, or the address of actual parameters. So this is called call by reference. So this time, if you are trying to actually run this particular code, so you will see, first of all, the output will be 10, 20, and next time it will be 10, 20, 10. For this particular statement, it will be 20, 10, because the values of this parameter x and y are altered using the pointer variables a and b. Clear? It is nothing but the extension of the properties of pointer, like that we have seen here. So this call by reference is just an extension to that particular thing. ক্লিয়ার হয়েছে? ওকে, নাও সাম অফ দ্য অ্যাপ্লিকেশনস অফ পয়েন্টার, উই আর নট গোয়িং টু গেট ইন টু মোর ডিটেলস, বাট সাম অফ দ্য অপারেশনস অফ সাম অফ দ্য অ্যাপ্লিকেশনস অফ পয়েন্টার. সো addition ক্র্যাশ করে যাচ্ছে. So pointers actually supports some of the operations like scalar addition. So what will happen? Suppose you have a 4 byte area here, you have another 4 byte area here, and this particular area is actually used by this variable a. So you have int a is equal to 5, suppose. So this is 5. Now what you have done, you have int pointer is equal to x, sorry, not x, int pointer is equal to ampersand of a. So what will happen? A pointer variable will have this, suppose addr, so addrp. So you link to this particular location is created, and this is named as pointer. Up to this point, everything is clear? That means we have a pointer variable that is located or that is pointing to the variable a. Now, some operations are actually allowed on pointer, that is addition operation. You can add pointer variable plus a scalar. That means we can add, scalar means any integer value. So instead of scalar, you can write integer. So you can add some integer value to your pointer. Okay. So we can actually write p is equal to p plus 1. Now it has a special effect. So if you write pointer p is equal to pointer p plus 1, you know what will happen. You know what will happen. This 5 will become 6. So using this particular statement. But if you are using p is equal to p plus 1, what will happen? What is the content of? Sorry. So using this particular statement, this particular 5 will become 6. But whenever you are writing p is equal to p plus 1, what will happen? Addr, that is the content of p, is equal to addr plus 1. Not addr plus 1. So addr plus 1 will be the content here. Now what we have said? We have said that p will point, always point to an integer. That means if we assume that the size of integer is 4 byte, so p will always point to 4 byte location. Okay, so if you just increase the value by 1, what it will do, this pointer p will now try to point the next 4 byte. So from this particular 4 byte, you can actually try to point the next 4 byte. So this is one of the advantages of pointer. Also, this is one of the security concern using a pointer as well. That means you can declare a single variable, and this is not like this. So you can actually access p is equal to p plus 2, p is equal to p plus 5 as well. That means you can actually move through your memory locations, and this is dangerous. That means when you have access to all the areas of your memory, so suppose your password, some password is stored in a memory, and you are creating a single variable inside your memory, and you are searching the whole area for that particular password. If you know what is the length of that particular password, you can easily access that particular password using pointer. So some users or some programmers actually says to avoid this pointer. So this pointer is nowadays only available to C and C++, because they are actually the last level or last language that is actually can work with or interact with the computer hardwares very efficiently. So C and C++ is sometimes called a middle level or intermediate between middle level and high level language. So they can actually interact with the hardware directly. So for that reason, pointers are there. So this is one of the dangerous thing as well as some of the usefulness of this particular addition operator we are going to see in the next slide. So as you can see, using this pointer, you can actually move through the different locations of 4 byte area. That means this, the next location is also going to store an integer. So we don't know what is the content of that particular value or that particular variable. It may be some garbage value, it may be something from different category. That means some extracted value from a double value. So it could be anything, but it will point to the next location. So if you write p is equal to p plus 2, it will point to the next 4 byte. In this way, you can actually move your pointer from one location to another location. Using these properties, array using this property, we can actually point different values of an array or different items of an array using a pointer location. So suppose if you have a pointer, if you have an array, say array ARR, where you have 5, 7, 2, 9, 3, 7, 8. Okay, so how we can define this? So for that we have to write integer ARR is equal to 5, 7, 2, 9, 3, 7, 8. So that is our content of the array. Now we define a pointer, say int pointer p. So this is our pointer. Now what we want? We want our pointer to point here at initially. Okay, so we want our pointer to point in this particular location. So what we can do that, or how we can do that? So pointer ARR or p is equal to ampersand of ARR 0. Now whoever was present in the previous class, you know that these two things are same. So ARR denotes, and the ampersand ARR, both of them denotes the base address or the address of first element. So both of them denotes the address of the first element. So what we have done here, we have pointed our pointer to the first location using either of these two statements. Okay, so now what will happen if you try to print %d and %p? Can anyone tell me what will be the output of this particular statement? Print a %d pointer p. Where does that particular pointer is located? Bolo bolo. Yeah, so it will be 5, because the pointer p is now located in this particular location. Now what will happen if you just do this? P is equal to p plus 1. P will automatically come from here and it will locate here. And if you print %d, it will print. What is the value it is going to print? 7. So in this way, you can actually print all the values by incrementing the pointer. By incrementing the pointer, you can actually access all the values of this particular pointer, this particular array. Is it clear? So so we are not going to actually go into details how to do that. You can actually so I'm just showing you. You don't have to, if you don't understand, there is no problem. So what you can write, a pointer variable, say p is equal to ampersand of not p is equal to ampersand of p is equal to the base address, what will be the end? So suppose the end is star p not equal to 8 in this scenario, and p plus plus. So if you write printf percent d pointer, say this will print your array. So as we know, what is the last number of this particular array, that is 8. So what we are going to check, if the value from the pointer is not 8, we just print everything and increment the pointer by 1. So this is how you can print everything inside your array. Now two more things comes. So if you use size of with an array, if you use size of with an array variable, what will happen? It will give you the size in byte of the entire array. Entire array in the sense, suppose you have a character array. So as we know that characters takes 1 byte, so that's why we are taking an example of character array. So char, suppose arr is equal to say a, b, and c. And now you have a pointer, suppose character pointer cp is equal to arr. Now if you use size of with this character pointer, what will be the result? I have said it so many times, what will be the result? If you use size of with a character pointer, what will be the result? Yes, so the result will be 8. And if you use size of arr, yes, so it will be 3, because this particular value requires 1 byte, this particular value requires 1 byte, and this particular value requires 1 byte. So it is not that number of elements, it is actually in byte. So 3 byte area is required for that particular array. So whenever you put size of array, it will give you the entire size of your array. So it will give you this kind of statement. So the output from this particular size of array will be 3. One more thing. Ampersand of CP and ARR, are both of them equal? Just some conceptual questions. Ampersand of CP and ARR, are they same? What is your logic saying? Yes, they are not same. Okay. I don't think there is anything more that you are required for your exams. Let me tell you what kind of questions can come from this particular session. Okay, before that, I'm going to stop.